mind and after learning. Tonight, our speaker is kind of a treat for me because a very good friend of mine, whom I met when I was assistant editor of Martin Luther King Papers Project, and he was taking a position at Emory University, South Atlanta. Robert E.G. Kelly is probably one of the brightest stars in the African-American intellectual community. He's written prize-winning books like Hammer and Hoe, Race Relics, and that wonderfully titled book, Your Mama's Dysfunction, Culture Wars in Urban Cities. Here tonight, sort of a token of friendship to me, because on November 9th, we had a brutal accident where he was walking across the street in Newark and was hit by a car in which his leg was broken and his knee shattered and the ligament separated. Hence, it is predictable. But as Rob did, he's come through it wonderfully. And as he told me tonight, he's canceled all of his lectures for this year, with the exception of one, this one, because he understood the importance of the WB and Shirley Graham Du Bois lecture. When I wrote him, I told him he could write or talk, rather, on whatever he wanted to talk about, and he wrote me back a lovely email in which my interest was piqued, because he's going to talk tonight about something that's been in the news for some time now, and has elicited a lot of controversy, but it's something that is the theme, in many ways, of this year's Black History Month. That is the legacy of slavery and the question of reparations. Now, before I formally again introduce him, I want to thank Interim President Jane Pynchon and her office, the Office of the Provost and Faculty, for their funding and generous funding of this and other bad lectures. There are departments too numerous to mention here, and I know you want to hear his voice and not mine rambling on. But for all of those departments and programs, we thank them dearly for their generosity in supporting this lecture this year and in the past. Without any further ado, please give a warm Colgate welcome to Dr. Robert E.G. Kelly, who's going to talk about a day of reckoning, Black dreams of reparations.
On the denial of human rights to minorities in the case of citizens of Negro descent. the United States of America in an appeal to the United States for redress. And this is a very detailed document that, although again, it doesn't make the demand for reparations, it certainly makes a demand for redress based on not just segregation, but all forms of oppression, lynching, the criminal justice system, inadequate education. So, having said that, I feel like the topic of reparations is one in the spirit of Du Bois, because I wouldn't want to do anything outside that spirit. And the debate afterwards should be within the spirit as well. The way I'd like to begin is the way I always begin, and that is a piece of music. So we're going to hear a tune by Oscar Brown Jr. that should be self-explanatory.
Come on down.
And even if you have to leave early, I don't mind. You know, it doesn't bother me. Okay. In any case, Jordan was suspicious of this letter. So with the help of Lydia Maria's child, prolific violent abolitionist, the school teacher, he dictated a response to his old master. And he began by expressing his concern that he and his wife, Mandy, were, and I quote from the letter, "afraid to go back without truth, that you were disposed to treat us justly and kindly. And we have concluded to test your sincerity by asking you to send us our wages for the time we served you. This will make us forget and forgive old scores and rely on your justice and friendship in the future. I served you faithfully for 32 years and Mandy 20 years. At $25 a month for me and $2 a week for Mandy, our earnings would amount to $11,680. Add to this the interest for the time our wages have been kept back and deduct what you paid for our clothing, three doctor's visits to me, and pulling a tooth for Mandy, and the balance will show what we are in justice entitled to. Please send the money by Adams Express in care of V. Winters Esquire, Dayton, Ohio." Okay, so he's asking for this check for $11,000 plus. You don't have to be so serious, by the way. I mean, you just reflect on this, because just imagine what it means for a slave to write his master and say, "Well, you know, I'll come back and work for you if you basically pay me my back wages." Okay? "If you fail to pay us for faithful labors in the past, we can have little faith in your promises in the future. We trust the good Maker has opened your eyes to the wrongs which you and your fathers have done to me and my father, making us toil for you for generations without recompense. Here I draw my wages every Saturday night, but in Tennessee, there was never any payday for the Negroes, any more than for horses and cows. Surely there will be a day of reckoning for those who defraud the laborer of his hire. In answering this letter, please state if there would be any safety for my Millie and Jane, who are now grown up and both good-looking girls. You know how it was with poor Matilda and Catherine. I would rather stay here and starve and die, if it come to that, than have my girls brought to shame by the violence and wickedness of their young masters. Say howdy to George Carter and thank him for taking the pistol from you when you were shooting at me." Now, by even the most elementary principles of liberal capitalism, Jordan Anderson presents a sound, reasonable case for receiving compensation for years of unpaid labor. He was a colonel's property, but the fact that he could reason like this distinguished him from the horses and the cows that also served the needs of a plantation without pay. Indeed, by today's standards, Jordan is being charitable by only asking for back wages and interest. He does not make a case for damages, despite the kind of physical and psychological abuse visited upon his whole family. The rape, the violence, the horrible living conditions, the mere fact of bondage. Now, obviously, most of us think this letter is, you know, not even realistic in some ways, if it's not funny. And I'm sure that the colonel laughed a bit when he read it. But almost 140 years have passed since the passage of the 13th Amendment ending slavery in the United States. And most of America is still dismissing demands for reparations, claiming that the very idea violates the basic principles of U.S. democracy and laissez-faire capitalism. And the most recent example, of course, is the World Conference Against Racism in Durban, where the official U.S. delegation pretty much rejected any claims against reparations. In fact, the leading voice against reparations in Africa was Belgium, of all nations. There's seats up in the front. There's at least one, two, three, four. There's about five or six seats. I'm so happy you made it. In any case, we're told in arguments against reparations that slavery's behind us. It's a thing of the past. Any payments to black people would not only be divisive, but discriminating, an act of discrimination against white people. We're told that black people have already received billions of dollars of aid through welfare and poverty programs, and therefore, if there was a debt owed, it has been paid many times over. Who received the bulk of that money is a discussion we can have afterwards. But it wasn't black people. We're told by right-wing critics like Dinesh D'Souza that the only people deserving of reparations were the slave masters. And presumably, their descendants since the government freed their property without compensation. Now, besides denying the basic humanity of the enslaved and not accounting for the tremendous wealth the master class acquired by exploiting unpaid labor, this twisted logic of D'Souza conveniently ignores the fact that the vast majority of slaveholders, you know, at the end of during the Civil War, had committed treason. Okay, this is basic history. They committed treason against the United States and were never punished. And in fact, Jordan's letter exposes this irony as well. He writes, "I thought the Yankees would have hung you long before this for harboring rats they found at your house. I suppose they never heard about your going to Colonel Martin's to kill the Union soldier that was left by his company in your stable." Now, for African Americans in search of freedom, reparations was never a laughing matter. As early as 1854, a convention of emigrationists called on the federal government to provide for a national indemnity as, quote, a redress of our grievances for the unparalleled wrongs which we suffered at the hands of this American people. Immediately after the Civil War, Sojourner Truth organized a petition seeking free public lands for former slaves. And she said, she argued, "America owes to my people some of the dividends. I shall make them understand that there is a debt to the Negro people which they can never repay. At least then, they must make amends." Now today, of course, as most of you know, there are countless proposals for reparations as partial compensation for slavery and or post-slavery racial discrimination. The growing support for reparations is partly linked to the passage of the Civil Liberties Act of 1988, which authorized reparations to Japanese Americans interned during the Second World War, and also Congressman John Conyers of Detroit, who has had this bill, in fact, first introduced in 1989, it's been in committee since then, to create a commission, just a commission to study the question of reparations for black people. And there's been many precedents as well. I mean, besides the internment of the Japanese and payments made, as well as payments to Jewish Holocaust victims, we can point to a couple of North American cases, the Alaska Claim Settlement of 1971, which the United States awarded indigenous Alaskans about $1 billion and more than 44 million acres of land. And of course, there's Rosewood, Florida. Some of you know about Rosewood from John Singleton's film. But in 1995, nine former residents of Rosewood, this all-black town, were awarded $150,000 each as restitution for property destroyed by white mobs during the 1923 pogrom. Given the overwhelming destruction and loss of life, these sums of money were hardly adequate. Nevertheless, the settlement set a precedent for all victims of racist violence and exploitation, especially when indirectly sanctioned by the state by legalized segregation, or in some instances, legalized slavery. And in fact, if you ever keep in touch, sort of keep up with the case in Tulsa, Oklahoma, where you know the downtown section, the black section of Tulsa was bombed in 1921, there's also room for reparations in that case. Now, partly as a result of these precedents and organizing efforts, we've seen a proliferation of books, articles, public debates about reparations based on all manner of legal arguments, economic calculations, the wide range of political moral arguments. But my purpose tonight is not to weigh the pros and cons of one proposal against another. That's not my interest. I'm not going to come up with some calculation of the price of slavery and racial discrimination. There's been a lot of work on that. If you want names of authors, we could talk about that later. What I want to talk about tonight is the historical vision and imagination that has animated this movement for reparations since the days of slavery. With the exception of groups like the National Coalition of Blacks for Reparations in America, called NCOBRA, or the Black Radical Congress, this vision of the future is sorely lacking in a lot of contemporary arguments for reparations. And we think of reparations not as a legal case, but as a social movement in the United States, we discover that it was never entirely about money. Okay? And this, I think this is very, very important. It's not even primarily about money. The demand for reparations was about social justice, reconciliation, reconstructing the internal life of black America, and eliminating institutional racism. This is why reparations proposals from a lot of the black radical movements I'm going to talk about don't focus on individual payments, but they focus rather on securing funds to build black institutions, improving community life, and in some cases, establishing a homeland that will enable African Americans to develop a political economy geared more toward collective needs than individual accumulation. And that's not the story you get. That's why you get these jokes, you know, by Chris Rock and others about talking about, you know, trying to get a Lexus or whatever. It's never really been about that. And what I want to do is sort of demonstrate what it's been about. And to do this, we have to go back to something else. If you go back to the moment of emancipation, or the end of the war, African-American troops who fought in this war and survived rightfully viewed themselves as liberators, okay? They viewed the ex-masters, the Confederacy, as the traitors, okay, the rebels. They believed that these traitors, these southern landowners, these plantation owners, that their land should be divided up among the folks who toiled so many generations without pay. And some of the ex-slaves did just that, parceling out their former masters' property, staking claims to abandoned plantation lands, preparing to inherit the earth they had turned into wealth for the idle white people. These expectations weren't totally crazy either, because in January of 1865, General William T. Sherman had issued Special Field Order Number 15, which designated lands along the South Carolina coast and the Sea Islands to be distributed among free people. Each family was to receive 40 acres, and General Sherman made some of the army mules and some of the confiscated animals available for cultivation. What was the idea behind this? To make these ex-slaves, make these free people self-sufficient. So they wouldn't be a burden on the government as far as he was concerned. Congress, altogether, some 40,000 free people settled on these seized lands. And Congress followed up 2 months later with what was called the First Freedmen's Bureau Bill, which promised to provide, quote, every male citizen, whether refugee or freedman, with not more than 40 acres of land. And of course, as you know from the story, President Andrew Johnson wasn't really having it. He promptly vetoed Congress's bill, reversed the order, and then in 1867, Thaddeus Stevens, who was a radical Republican, tried again, introducing a resolution to Congress calling for the enforcement of what was called the Confiscation Act of 1861, which seized a lot of the ex-Confederate land. 1 million families, according to this plan, would have received 40-acre plots and $50 of cash to start a money. Stevens believed the South should pay an indemnity for the war, because they started it. And the seizure of land was part of the payment. It would have also broken the back of the plantation economy, since the power and wealth of the planter class, if you recall from your basic U.S. history, depended on what? The availability of cheap black labor. So cheap black labor would have disappeared because they would have been self-sufficient. Okay? The old plantations would have been broken up. But it didn't happen. Congress didn't support this bill. Eventually, under President Johnson, nearly all the land confiscated from the Confederacy was restored to the old plantation owners in exchange for an oath of loyalty. Although the Freedmen's Bureau was created to administer the needs of black people, it actually only controlled about 0.2% of the land in the South, which they tried to distribute. And a lot of that land actually wasn't even cultivatable, it wasn't arable, as they said. African Americans began this period of Reconstruction then, landless, frustrated, and though they remained hopeful that the federal government would fulfill its promise of land. And in fact, at mass meetings and churches, in the privacy of their own homes, they spoke of getting the 40 acres, not as some kind of gift or handout, but as payment for slavery, for wages they never received. And in fact, a few radical Republicans continued to press for redistribution of land. Meanwhile, pro-planter forces pressured the federal government to compensate not ex-slaves, but the ex-slave holders. Okay? And there's at least one case in Washington, D.C., where Congress passed a law in 1862 actually compensating slave owners for freeing their slaves. Okay? But they got a little bit of money for that. Not a little bit, quite a bit, actually. By the late 19th century, the movement to secure some kind of restitution for African Americans was given a new life when a guy named William Vaughn, who was a white Democrat from Alabama, launched launched a national movement to grant a pension to ex-slaves. There was no pension. There was no 401ks in those days. They had pensions for people who fought in the war, but no pensions for ex-slaves. So Bond believed that such a pension plan was not only just, but it would relieve Southern taxpayers from the burden of supporting a rapidly aging black population. And just an aside, one of the big myths about the Jim Crow South is that black people were a tax burden. On the contrary, in many cases, African-American tax-paying laboring populations carried more than their share of the burden to the point of subsidizing public services for white people. And I'm going to talk about that at the end. Now, Vaughn proposed that ex-slaves 70 years and older receive an initial payment of $500 and then $15 a month until they die. Okay, and then it would be graduated. So if you're 60 to 70, you receive $300, $12 a month. Ex-slaves 50 to 60 would receive $100 or $8 a month. Between 1890 and 1903, Bond succeeded in getting 9 bills to this effect introduced into Congress, but none became law. And in fact, none of these bills got passed committee. Bond tried to drum up grassroots support for a pension campaign, but soon found himself competing with other ex-slave pension movements. And in fact, a few of the groups that emerged in this period were like hustlers, basically. They were frauds intent on stealing from unsuspecting black people. Individuals in these fake organizations would falsely represent themselves as club organizers or as officers of the US government, then collect fees and then issue certificates, okay, which the newly recruited members were told they needed in order to verify their former status as slaves. So they go around the South, basically getting money from people and then disappearing. The African Americans who bought into these phony clubs mailed the bogus certificates to the Pension Bureau for payment, only to be told that the certificates were worthless. Now, although Bond himself was never indicted for fraud, it's worth noting, such something to reflect on, that by the time his movement collapsed in 1903, he had earned over $100,000 in fees, that he collected from this pension project. Now, one of the organizations challenging Bond's clubs was the Ex-Slave Mutual Relief Bounty and Pension Association, which was founded in 1897 by two African Americans, Reverend Isaiah Dickerson and Mrs. Callie House. Now, the purpose of the organization was to get a federal bill passed and to build a broad movement that could provide mutual assistance to its members. And it seems as though this organization and some of the chapters function like kind of like a mutual benefit association, like people helping each other, reinforcing a strong sense of community, a sense of mission in some ways. But from the time they launched the movement in 1897, the federal government began investigating Dickerson and House, and in March of 1901, Dickerson was imprisoned for, quote, obtaining money under false pretense. And then 13 years later, Callie House, who now headed the association, was indicted on mail fraud. Now, she ended up pleading guilty, claiming that she thought the pension bill had passed and had been sincerely working to help ex-slaves file claims. And her defense is plausible, especially considering the fact that neither she nor Dickerson made any money off the project. Nevertheless, by 1917, the Ex-Slave Mutual Relief Bounty and Pension Association, last organization fighting for pension legislation, had been thoroughly destroyed. Now, by the time we get to the first half of the 20th century, few African-American movements took up the demands for reparation. Instead, that slogan of 40 acres and a mule became more like a slogan of false promises, as it is now. I mean, when people use it, it's sort of like the term that they use, which also has certain racial connotations, Indian giver, you promised me this and stole my land. 40 acres and a mule is again, another shorthand for broken promises. Now, the Garvey movement condemned Europe's seizure of Africa and its wealth, including its people, and called, colonialism an act of theft. And in fact, the Universal Negro Improvement Association, Garvey's organization, vowed to reclaim Africa, but made no direct request for reparations. However, explicit demands for some kind of indemnity began to pick up steam after World War II. in part inspired by the creation of the State of Israel, and Germany's reparations to Holocaust victims, which began in earnest in 1952. All told, Germany paid about $58 million in reparations. And when the circulation of this idea had an impact on certain black organizations in the post-war period. And not surprisingly, this issue of territorial land came back again among those organizations pushing for reparations. Organizations such as the 49th State Movement, okay, and the African Nationalist Independence Partition Party in North America advocated reparations in the form of land on which to create a black state or black nation. In the latter's Declaration of Self-Determination of the African American Captive Nation, issued in January 1963, the statement argued for restitution based on the fact that the U.S. was, quote, built with the unrequited labor, slave labor, of our African ancestors, end quote. As restitution, okay, the organization, the declaration itself demanded that, quote, all land south of the Mason-Dixon line, where our people constitute the majority, be partitioned to establish a territory for self-government for the African nation in the United States. Okay, do you understand that? In other words, they're basically saying that black people constitute the majority in the South, so they have a right to that land and to create a separate nation. Now, that idea is not a new idea. Actually, the Communist Party had supported it back in the late 20s and early 30s. There were some even in the teens who supported this idea of a black nation, either in the South or the Northwest. But it picked up steam again. Now, one of the pioneers of this reparations movement in the post-war period was a woman by the name of Queen Mother Audley Moore. Just out of curiosity, has anyone heard of Queen Mother Moore? Raise your hand if you have. This is one person. Wow. When I was your age, I was fortunate to hear her speak at Long Beach State University. And she was a hero. You know, because she's been pushing for reparations she spent half her life doing that. And so even does that. You all weren't even born when I was in college. That's like 1981, I saw her. It was the most amazing thing to see this woman who at the time must have been at least 75 years old, maybe not that old, but she was up there pushing for reparations for black people. And anyway, she was a major figure in the history of black radicalism. She started out as a member of the Marcus Garvey movement in the 20s. In the 1930s, she joined the Communist Party and stayed with them until about 1950. And when she left the Communist Party, she founded, among other things, a group called the Universal Association of Ethiopian Women, which focused attention on welfare, prisoners' rights, anti-lynching, and interracial rape issues. She also launched the African American Party of National Liberation in 1963. And by her recollections, she came to the issue of reparations in 1962, after discovering a clause in a Methodist encyclopedia, and these are her words, that, quote, considers an enslaved people satisfied with their condition if the people do not demand equality before 100 years have passed. So, as the centennial of the Emancipation Proclamation was coming up the following year, she promptly formed a group called the Reparations Committee of Descendants of U.S. Slaves Incorporated, and issued a demand for federal reparations as partial compensation to slaves in Jim Crow. Her organization came up with a figure of $500 trillion to be spread over the next four generations. So $500 trillion to be raised in over the next four generations paid to descendants of U.S. slaves. And she made a case to President Kennedy, which of course didn't succeed, because if it did, I wouldn't have to be here giving a lecture. Life would be different. Now, the crucial point that Queen Mother Moore was pushing was emphasizing, making the demand that what's needed is a thoroughly democratic structure so that ordinary people can decide what to do with the money. In other words, it wasn't just a matter of transferring money to some institution, but creating a structure to be able to allow ordinary people to make the decision about what to do with it. The money was not to be controlled by some little clique, as she put it, nor was it intended to line the pockets of individuals. It had to be both substantial and community control to enable African Americans to, quote, put up some steel mills, some industry with the reparations, to benefit the whole people. She also wanted to accommodate those who, quote, wanted to take the reparation and go to Africa. Okay. What she did not want, and she said it over and over again, was a poverty program. Okay. She insisted that had the government focused on reparations rather than the war on poverty, Black people would have been much better off. Besides being a pittance of what was owed Black people as far as she was concerned, she complained that it gave the government and a handful of Black elites control over our own destiny. And the very idea that African Americans were damaged goods in need of help had dire psychological consequences. And she says, we don't realize how detrimental it is for us to be under a poverty program. We, who gave the world civilization, we, the wealthiest people on earth, who have been robbed of all of our birthright, our inheritance. So apparently, you know, the Emancipation Proclamation, the centennial for the Emancipation Proclamation, not only inspired Queen Mother Moore and other organizations to sort of raise the issue of reparations again, but also inspired a few artists to reflect on the cost of slavery and Jim Crow in Black America. The song I played for you at the beginning of this was recorded in 1964 by Oscar Brown Jr., who himself was an amazing songwriter, composer, playwright, who was very active. What I'd like to play for you now is just a segment of song by a songwriter named Abby Lincoln, which was recorded in 1961, and it's called Retribution. I think the words are self-explanatory. So just listen.
Racist has taken part in the slaughter of over 50 million Black people.
Now, the Panthers, as you probably know, never came up with a plan, but the principle that African Americans deserve reparations was central to their platform. Now, the Black Manifesto, issued in the spring of 1969, was the first systematic, fully elaborate plan for reparations to come out of the Black Freedom Movement. The document came about when James Foreman, who was a leader in an organization called Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, was asked to speak in Detroit at a conference called the National Black Economic Development Conference. And Foreman and activists he had met in Detroit, you know, pretty much kind of took over the conference, pushed the socialist agenda, and then he drafted this document called the Black Manifesto, which demanded $500 million in reparations to be paid by white Christian churches. Okay? $500 million in reparations to be paid by white Christian churches. Later they included synagogues. But that was the main thing. He wasn't even asking money from the government. Why was that? In part because he argued for the long history of particularly Christian institutions in the slave trade. $500 million, of course, is a paltry sum, and by the estimate, it came out to about $15 a head. But for Foreman and for those who drafted the Black Manifesto, they saw it as seed money to build a new revolutionary movement and to strengthen Black political and economic institutions. So at the top of the list, like how to spend this $500 million, top of the list was land. Okay, given the long history of African American struggles for land, it's not surprising that $200 million of this money was earmarked for what was called a Southern Land Bank. Okay. Because of their explicit anti-capitalist vision, the land bank was intended especially for, quote, people who want to establish cooperative farms but who have no funds. It wasn't to enrich individuals to become wealthy farmers, but to form cooperative farms. So they had it wasn't just about property, it was about transforming relationships with one another. Some of the other demands turned out to be even more imaginative. To protect Black workers and their families at work as well as within their unions, the manifesto designated $20 million for National Black Labor Strike Fund. Okay. A National Black Labor Strike Fund. That is, when you go on strike, if you're a Black worker, you get support from this fund to help you survive while you're not getting wages. And to help welfare recipients organize more effectively, the manifesto planned to give the National Welfare Rights Organization a subsidy of $10 million. Okay. The manifesto also recognized the racist war being waged on Black people's image here and abroad. So Foreman and other drafters of the document wanted African Americans to accept more control over the media. So they insisted that the media and the educational system, had been brainwashing Black youth and the teaching, quote, us to believe in the USA and salute the flag and go off to Santo Domingo, the Congo, or Vietnam, fighting for this white Christian nation, and that's in their words. And so they earmarked $40 million to launch publishing houses in Detroit, Atlanta, Los Angeles, New York, and another $40 million to be used for four television networks. They see there's a difference. They're not saying each person is gonna get a certain subsidy for their family, but they're gonna build these institutions. Television networks, publishing companies. They wanted $30 million to build a research skills center to facilitate the study of the problems of Black people in their work, and $10 million for a skills training center to teach community organization, photography, movie making, television and radio manufacturing and repair, and other communications related skills. Another $20 million will be used to support a United Black Appeal responsible for raising money for the organization. And then they wanted to fund what they call a Black Anti-Defamation League, which will protect our African image, in their words. The appeal would promote the development of cooperatives in African countries and provide material support to African liberation movements, which are fighting against colonialism and against Portuguese in particular. The remaining $130 million was to be used to establish a Black university in the South, which was a kind of acknowledgement that the majority of historically Black colleges and universities in the region at the time were largely funded and administered by liberal whites. Now, of course, this seems like a ridiculous order to be sure, but monetarily, What they were asking for was less than what most reparations movements were asking for. And in order to realize the Black Manifesto's demand, Foreman proposed a massive civil disobedience campaign directed at churches. So they would go into churches and disrupt the sermon, you know, particularly John White's sermon. They had sit-ins, mass disruptions, and they attacked the institutionalized church itself. Now, the amazing thing about this is that in some ways they succeeded. You know, they didn't get $500 million, but some of the religious leaders were moved by this mass campaign. They were moved by arguments that, you know, they were moved and empathetic with the plight of Black people. So as a result, the movement raised over $1 million. Okay, most of it, not all of it went actually to the Black Economic Development Conference, but about $300,000 of it did, and most of that was parceled out to other movements. And as a result, the one thing that they were able to do from this was to launch Black Star Publications. Now for Foreman and the radical leadership of this organization, the Black Manifesto was not an end in itself. They wanted to revolutionize the society. And they knew that even if their campaign succeeded, money alone would not lead to the kind of society they hoped to build. As Foreman explained, quote, reparations did not represent any kind of long-range goal in our minds, but an intermediate step on the path to liberation. We saw it as a politically correct step, for the concept of reparation reflected the need to adjust past wrongs, to compensate for the enslaving of Black people by Christians, and their subsequent exploitation by Christians and Jews in the United States. Our demands did not merely involve money, but would be a call for revolutionary action, a manifesto that spoke of the human misery of Black people under capitalism and imperialism and pointed the way to ending those conditions. So in 1971, the same organization formed the Black Workers' Congress. They tried to realize the anti-capitalist vision. Within 3 years, the movement kind of collapsed, and it actually became a multiracial Marxist-Leninist party, and in the process, they purged Foreman. So he got pushed out of that organization. But the main point is that the issue of reparations was brought to a national audience as a result of the Black Manifesto. And it kind of proved to be a success. During the early 70s, a bunch of articles and books came out on reparations. And the issue was everywhere. The Review of Black Political Economy had several articles about reparations. In 1972, a white law professor named Boris Bitford published The Case for Black Reparations, which argued for redress not for slavery, but for segregation, arguing that Jim Crow violated the Equal Protection Clause of the 14th Amendment. He also found language in what was basically an anti-Klan statute passed during Reconstruction, which provided redress to any injured party deprived of their constitutional rights. So we have this flurry of publications and debates advance, you know, and all these debates advance the economic and juridical case for reparations. But most of these books and articles were not concerned with the larger question, that is, how do we construct society? Okay? In contrast to the professors, other social movements picked up where the Black Manifesto took off or left off. The Republican New Africa, for example, had roots in Detroit. They advocated reparations with the intention of building an independent Black nation in the United States. They also took the position that the states of the South, particularly South Carolina, Georgia, Alabama, Mississippi, and Louisiana, constituted a subjugated territory, and that those who reside in that territory have a right to self-determination. They demanded that the U.S. government hand over the territory to African Americans and establish the RNA as a government in exile. And in addition, they called for reparations from the U.S. government in the amount of $400 billion in order to sustain the new nation during these first 2 years. Now, the plan, which was authored by Imari Obadeli in 1972, was called the Anti-Depression Program of the Republic of New Africa. And it's worth paying attention to what they're asking for. Because in it, he portrays the new nation as a beautiful, free space for Black people, kind of somewhat reminiscent of the way in which a lot of African Americans imagine Africa. It stood in stark contrast to the overcrowded, rat-infested ghettos that many urban African Americans knew as home. But the promise of a Republic of New Africa also meant transforming the ghettos and the personalities in North America. And he wrote, "We shall bring a new dimension in breathing and growing space for those who remain where they are. We shall immensely relieve pressure on the crowded and northern western ghettos and spatially and materially restructure and abolish the growing black slums of the South. The new nation would not follow the path of American capitalism. Rather, the economy was based on the model that emerged in me at the time, and that is, you know, you've heard the term Ujamaa, probably around Kwanzaa time, right? Ujamaa. But I'm sure that most of you celebrate Kwanzaa, right? Ujamaa basically loosened cooperative economics. And so the idea was to try to create a social society based on African principles. What those principles are, we could debate and discuss later, but the idea that in their head, they believed that there was something unique about African cultures that could produce a social society, and that's what they wanted to produce, to create in the United States. And that is a system for need and not for profit. Now, the means of production in New Africa, Obadeli declared, will be in the trust of the state to best accomplish this end and further ends of rapidly ending want and creating surplus. Now, a lot of critics, to this day, are quick to dismiss any sort of territorial nationalism. Like the idea of black people having their own state. Because you know that the day comes up all the time. Would you go? You know, would you leave your, you know, home in Hamilton to go like to the South? You know, that's the question. But we gotta think of it not in terms of practicality, but in terms of imagination. We need to treat the land issue in terms of things like controlling, not just controlling territories, national borders, but, you know, and not just in terms of wealth, you know, which is another issue which we could talk about at the end. But in terms of a territory on which people can begin to reconstruct their lives. Proponents of a new state or repatriation to another place are really just looking for a new beginning, a place they could feel free and develop their own culture without interference. It's a free space. The dream, after all, is to create a new society free of an overseer's watchful eye. And of course, you know this dream from the Bible. It's Exodus. You know, you read the Bible, you know. I just recently read it about a week ago. It's an interesting book. But Exodus, this is the story of Exodus. Exodus, you know, is not just about leaving. It's about creating a new land, you know, having a new beginning. And so this is how they imagine the communal villages in North America. So, if the new lands are available, is it possible, the question that we could raise is it possible to persuade people of the old land to support the same things the movement wants? In other words, can groups like the Republic of New Africa win non-black support for the program and turn the whole United States into the kind of society they imagine for the Republic of New Africa? You know, that's a question. On the surface, the question may seem absurd, but when we examine RNA's broad aims, his general commitment to liberation of humanity is crystal clear. Despite his nationalism and his rubric of non-nationalism, the aims of the anti-depression program are deeply internationalist and humanist, in that it calls for the overthrow of all forms of oppression around the globe and aims to make new subjects who are self-reliant, intelligent, self-possessed, and committed to social change. The RNA made it perfectly clear here in that program and in other statements and actions, that these larger goals cannot be accomplished by simply receiving land and money from the state. Now, I'm going to skip a bunch of stuff here because, you know, I want to get to the discussion. But in some ways, Republic of New Africa remade itself. It experienced immense repression in the 1960s, during the 70s. It resurrected itself as a new African movement. And they formed Inkhobra. And Inkhobra is the current sort of, it's the most important voice for the reparations movement today, that's a social movement. And right now, their demands include $25,000 in cash for black families and individuals, and the immediate release of all political prisoners, as well as nonviolent black prisoners with cash reparations, and for those who needed medical care and substance abuse treatment. Okay, this is not a demand you normally hear in reparations cases. The release of all political prisoners as well as non-violent black prisoners with cash reparations and for those who needed medical care and substance abuse treatment. $10 billion to create 10 schools to, quote, retrain African-American youth, the unemployed, and recently released prisoners. And $1 billion to create an economic development fund that would act for local economic development in African-American communities. In short, Inkover continues to uphold a radical concept of reparations as more than a paycheck and an apology. They regard the campaign as part of a many-pronged attack on race and class oppression, an analysis of the root cause of inequality, and a means to mobilize African-Americans to struggle for social change and for self-reliance. And in fact, self-reliance is a key phrase in Inkover and the New African Movement. And as they consistently promote educational programs with the intention of reducing crime, drug addiction, and self-hatred, and promoting communal values, self-worth, and a commitment to community. Again, these are also, this is the language you don't hear, because this is not about a give-back or a handout. This is about self-transformation. Grassroots community involvement in the campaign not only builds support, but has the potential of transforming participants through study groups, forums, in relationships forged in the context of social movement. And let me just close with a few wild thoughts on the relationship between reparations and this issue of transformation. Now, if we think of reparations as part of a broad strategy to radically transform society, that is, redistributing wealth, creating a democratic and caring public culture, exposing the ways in which capitalism and slavery produce massive inequality, then an ongoing struggle for reparations holds enormous promise for revitalizing movements of social justice. Now consider the context. First, for the last quarter century, we've witnessed a general backlash against African-American communities. Republican and Democratic administrations dismantled most state protections for poor people of color, expanded the urban police state, and I live in New York, where it's expanding right now, virtually eliminated a lot of affirmative action programs and welfare as we know it, and significantly weakened institutions and laws created to protect civil rights. Second, all these cutbacks were justified by a discourse that blames black behavior for contemporary urban poverty, and turned what were once called rights into privileges, so like welfare, for example, is a privilege rather than a right. Third, the argument for reparations not only recast these measures as rights, but as payback. It shows how over two centuries of U.S. policy facilitated accumulation among white property owners while further impoverishing African Americans. This federal assistance to black people in any form is not a gift, but a down payment for centuries of unpaid labor, violence, and exploitation. And, you know, if you don't see the other way, one of the big issues that comes up when you talk about welfare payments, and this discussed very powerfully in a book by the possessive, book by George Lipsitz called The Possessive Investment of Whiteness, where he shows, among other people, that much of the making of post-war suburbia was a product of federal payments, federal subsidies, housing policies that actually reduce the housing stock or the value of housing stock in mixed communities, Latino communities and black communities, and raise the housing stock in white suburban communities. In some ways, the accumulation of wealth that we know that becomes the kind of post-war middle-class miracle coming out of suburbs had a lot to do with racial politics in U.S. policy and subsidy welfare in some ways that made it possible. And we could talk about that, but that's a very important part of the argument. In fact, we don't even have to talk about housing. We could talk about education. Take one example. During Reconstruction, African Americans led the fight for free universal public education in the United States, not just for themselves, but for them. How many people know that? Raise your hand if you know that. That African Americans were at the forefront of free universal public education. You could read W.E.B. Du Bois, whose letter is named after. Read Black Reconstruction. He lays that out. It's a very powerful argument, and it's documented. They were pushing for education for all people, not just for themselves, poor whites who didn't have access to public education before. Now, after being barred from reading and writing while in bondage, newly freed people regard education as one of the most basic rights and privileges of citizenship. Education was so important, in fact, they were willing to pay for public schools or start at home. There's lots of examples of black people raising money to do so. Now, as soon as the federal government withdrew its support for Reconstruction, and the Southern planter class and New South industrialists imposed formal segregation, black students end up being relegated to inferior schools, and in fact denied full attendance. Rural schools for African Americans, for example, only operated a few weeks out of the year, whereas for schools for white kids, it's, you know, a full 9 months, for the most part. It was not unusual for the Jim Crow South, in Jim Crow South, for African Americans to contribute 40% of a school budget, of an urban school budget, for example, but attend schools that receive 10% of expenditures. Okay, do you understand the math here? In other words, African Americans were literally subsidizing white schools, subsidizing white education. One study conducted by researchers in Atlanta University in 1901 came to that conclusion. And more recently, 2 years after the Supreme Court ordered desegregation of schools in 1954, Brown versus Board of Education, the state of Virginia introduced publicly funded school vouchers to help white families send their children to private schools rather than endorse integration. Okay? Publicly funded vouchers, which they could use, and part of that was paid for by who? By black taxpayers. So in the short period of time, until vouchers were deemed unconstitutional, these vouchers, which actually make it a comeback, during the short period of time, African-American taxes were being used to help pay for white children's private school tuition. That's recent. That's within the last half century. Okay, now in light of how separate and unequal education has benefited whites and cost African Americans, claims that affirmative action is reverse discrimination or special privilege ring hollow at best. The reparations movement exposes the history of white privilege and helps us all understand how wealth and poverty are made under capitalism. It stresses the fact that labor creates wealth, not CEOs, that scientists and technicians, not CEOs, not scientists and not technicians, not the magic of the so-called free market. It provides an analysis of our situation that challenges victim-blaming explanations, demonstrating that exploitation and aggressive policies create poverty and not bad behavior. It ought to compel us to pay attention to the importance of race in the U.S. political economy, since one of the consequences of racial difference, or racial differential in income, is downward pressure on wages for all people, irrespective of color. So, racist policies affect working class white people. If you have downward pressure on all wages as a result of a racially segmented labor market, then the wages for white people cannot go up. It may be higher than black people, may be higher than Latinos, but it brings downward pressure on all wages. Okay? And the other thing is that the issue of reparations should also make us look at gender. Since men and women did not experience exploitation in the same manner, we need to consider things like women's unpaid labor, reproduction, you know, as labor, particularly under slavery and afterwards, sexual abuse, and the ways we can make restitution for these distinctive forms of exploitation. At the very least, the reparations movement ought to clarify issues like what constitutes a family, what payments are to be made to such units, or how we might imagine remaking relationships between men, women, boys and girls, adults and children. There can be no discrimination in a reparations, a true reparations movement, against same-sex domestic partners or single mothers, nor should they be viewed as some sort of cultural aberration. If radical transformation of society is one of the goals of the reparations movement, then these questions can't be ignored. Unfortunately, most arguments in support of reparations scarcely make mention of gender, nor have they imagined governing structures based on gender equity. So in the end, a successful reparations campaign has the potential of benefiting the entire nation, not just the black community. Okay? The reparations campaign has the potential of benefiting the entire nation, not just the black community. Since most plans emphasize investments in institutions rather than individuals, rather than social payments, the result would bring massive infusion of capital for infrastructure, housing, schools, and related institutions in communities with large black populations. Monies would also be made available to support civic organizations and help establish a strong civil society among people of African descent, which in turn would strengthen civil society as a whole. Presumably, all the social ills like crime and drug use, violence would be reduced. But more importantly, the image of black people would change. Because so many of those crimes are actually public representations that actually affect the whole society, not just African Americans. Furthermore, the historically black ghetto communities, as for ghetto in quotes, to which substantial investments would be made, also housed other poor people of color. These are communities that house Latinos. In South Central Los Angeles, it's majority Latino population. You know, Afro-Caribbeans, Native Americans, Asian Americans, namely Filipinos, Samoans, South Asians, and Koreans, they too would benefit from improved schools, improved homes, improved public life, and a politically strengthened community. Given the relationship between slavery and racism to the global economy, this outcome makes perfect sense. Many of these poor immigrant groups are themselves products of centuries of imperialism, and some are descendants of slaves, as in the case of Afro-Caribbean and Latin American rivals. Finally, it should be stressed that reparations for one group would not harm working class whites, and there's lots of explanations for that we can talk about. And let me just close with the words of Reverend Radical Gracie Boggs. For decades, she's been making this very point, insisting that we stop begging for inclusion in a corrupt system, take responsibility for transforming our culture, and we make ourselves as human beings. And hopefully all of us who believe in freedom, believe freedom is worth pursuing, will heed her words and recognize the power we already possess. And she says, quote, "What we need to do is encourage groups of all kinds and all ages to participate in a vision of the future that will enlarge the humanity of all of us. And in devising concrete programs in which they can work together, if only in a small way, move toward a vision. When people come together voluntarily to create their own vision, they begin wishing it to come true or come into being with such passion that they begin creating an active path leading to it from the present. The spirit and the way to make the spirit live coalesce. Instead of seeing ourselves only as victims, we begin to see ourselves as part of a continuing struggle of human beings, not only to survive, but to evolve into more human beings." And I'll stop here. Thank you.
Certainly for Native Americans and certainly seizure of land.
know, and even beyond that, way beyond. You can make an argument for basically people of Mexican descent, Mexican Americans in the Southwest, who also are Native American descent in that respect, in terms of seizure of land, the exploitation of labor. You can make cases for the way in which coal miners in the Southeast, for example, were treated. The point is, you don't have people lined up to make a case for reparations in the way that people lined up, lawyers lined up to sue a company, like Enron, for example. You know, it's not the same thing. My biggest concern is not actual transfer of money per se, but it is about producing a social movement that I think a lot of white people should support, and people of color across the board should support the idea of reparations, and really put a commitment into it, because in some ways it enables them to see themselves as a product of privilege, privilege that was itself in some ways calculated. You know, it allows all kinds of people, working people in particular, to understand that if they're poor, it's not really because they're just dumb or they don't work hard enough, but it's because the way in which wealth is structured. Reparations can't succeed as an actual transfer of money, but what it can succeed in doing is producing a kind of mass social movement that would say we want a different society. You know, we want to have a different relationship to wealth. We don't want to have like a bunch of wealthy people who basically have so much control over. The amazing thing is that anyone who's a working person for Enron should support reparations. You know, because part of what happened was they had no control over their company in terms of who made these certain decisions. You know, they didn't really have much of a vision besides the idea of accumulate wealth. But one of the things, and these are I talked about, these particular things, I didn't talk about Randall Robinson, I didn't talk about Robert Weston and all those other people, is because I'm interested in what is it that they imagine society should look like. You know? So if they got the money, what would they do with it? Now, of course, you could argue all night long about if they really got the money, what would they do with it? Animal farm situation. Well, that's, to me, less important than the fact that they had a vision laid out, and that vision involved transforming people's attitudes, giving them a sense of self-worth, providing resources for everybody in the community, and making sure that, as they used to say in the old days, like, all boats were lifted, you know. Thinking about wealth as a community property rather than an individual property. And that philosophy behind it is the thing that I think people would get behind. Not the philosophy behind simply giving people payments, saving them saying it's all over. You know, that could.
So I think that the legacy of slavery is the second thing that plays a crucial role in what makes this
history different. And then the final thing is, you know, it comes down to racial justice. Actually, it's four things. Racial justice is another thing. I mean, the history of Jim Crow and racism is something that has a distinct, unique history in which even white working people participate and benefit from it. You know, like, if you think about Cecil Rhodes, you know, this is an English example, but Cecil Rhodes himself was very clear. He said, you know, we have all these class tensions in England, and we're going to have to do something about it. One thing we have to do is basically create an empire and let the working class share in the fruits of that empire. Otherwise, we're going to have civil war. And in some ways, as much as the white working class suffered because of slavery, I really mean this, their lives were worse because of it. And their life was worse because of Jim Crow. They nevertheless received certain benefits from slavery and racial discrimination. And those little pithy benefits was enough for them to produce a sense of solidarity. And like I was listening to a friend of mine, Eric Mandy, the other day, speak. He says, you know, this is such a striking statement. It's like in LA. It was amazing how, you know, for all the, well, what did he say? He said, there's two examples he put side to side. One was the example of Conseco. I don't know if you know the story about Conseco, this financing company that basically stole from a lot of poor whites by financing trailer, you know, 18% financing on trailer homes. And these homes have never appreciated. And there's no massive opposition for the straight theft from these poor white people, many of whom are now going bankrupt as a result of the fact that they're paying 80% interest on something they can never appreciate, okay? There's no opposition to that. But, mention OJ, it doesn't matter what white person, someone has an opinion on it, you know? And it's amazing how what he makes this point, because I thought about it, it's like, you know, people are so angry that someone like OJ Simpson, you know, whether he's guilty or not, that's not the point, but OJ Simpson is a wealthy black man to get off. And how could that happen? They get so angry about it. And so what he's saying is that just the emotional investment in being white sometimes is more powerful than the logic of supporting your class. That was a tragedy of Reconstruction. You know, that's not to say that can't change. And see, this is the amazing thing, just to extend your question even further. I really do believe that history bears this out, that when you do have a lot of white people supporting movements for justice, it's not always economic populism that does this. It's anti-racism. I mean, think about it. In the 1960s, what brought a lot of white people into the movement wasn't like, okay, we're just all poor working people and we want it. It was anti-racism. It was the civil rights movement that brought them in. During Reconstruction, when the Republican Party was big in the South, and a lot of poor whites supported it, some of it was like, you know, okay, I can get the right to vote for a change. But a lot of these were white people who supported the idea of racial justice. Racial justice you could actually win white people around racial, not everyone, but you could win them easier sometimes from trying to make an economic populist argument. Isn't that amazing? That means that race is one of these central themes that runs through this country that's so powerful that it can lead to both mobilization and collective action and, you know, division, sharp division. See, and that's why it's a very tricky thing. That part of the system.
Yeah. If the federal government weren't paying reparations today, like my family, everyone I'm related to got here after the Civil War. We still have no slaves. Would we still pay as everyone else? Would we pay less? Would we pay all?
Well, it's an interesting question because there are a couple of things going on. One is that, you know, a lot of people have descendants who came in the late 19th century, if not post-World War II. And the question always comes up, well, you know, I'm white, but I have nothing to do with slavery. Now, we have to ask the question, after the end of slavery, are there legacies of white supremacy which you benefit, your family benefited from? Of course. You know, those benefits have to do with stuff that I talked about today, education program. Does that mean that you personally owe anything? That's not the point. The point is not, okay, you know, I'm taking a collection. No, give me my reparations. All you're going to do. It's not that at all. But it's about coming up with an analysis that begins by understanding the way in which white supremacy in the antebellum period and the postbellum period actually has, in small and big ways, depending on who you are, benefited a lot of white people. In a direct sort of way. It doesn't mean that you then go into your house and bring something out as payment. What it means is that we've got to ask ourselves, is this the kind of society we want? For example, for a long time before World War II, you don't have a lot of black people in universities and colleges. It's because we were dumber? No, it had to do with certain kinds of barriers that were put up in place. And, you know, and the same thing in terms of women, same thing in terms of Jews. Well, I wouldn't even consider, 100% white. See? If you think of this at Columbia University, where they worked very hard to keep Jews out of that institution. And when they did, segregated them. You know? In some ways, there's a history of a racial legacy that goes back to the Enlightenment, which is deeply anti-Semitic, which is tied directly to anti-black racism as well. What does this mean? What it means is that we have to have an analysis of the way in which these racial legacies operate for all of us. Now, on the other hand, there's a whole group of people with descendants of Eastern European Jews and Southern European Jews who came to the United States who suffered and struggled and in the post-war period were able to make that transition into whiteness. Okay? And benefit from very specific things, federal housing policies that, in some ways provided loans, low-interest loans for people, many of whom were veterans who served the country. And yet some of those same housing policies put low ratings on homes in black and Latino communities where they could own the home, they could never get appreciation, they never produce the wealth. That's a direct benefit. What does that mean? It doesn't mean that you then sell your home and give all the proceeds to the urban league. It simply means that you participate, I urge you to participate in a social movement that's about transforming a society so that we don't have to have white privilege anymore. And so that even many people who are not black participate in a vision of the Republican New Africa. Now there's a lot of problems with the vision I didn't talk about. A lot of problems with a certain kind of nationalism which is very problematic. But in terms of the general principles, a vision of a society in which education is available for all, everyone has basic resources, everyone has food to eat, place to live, everyone can pursue happiness, people can love each other without having to be penalized. See, that's what I think we're struggling for. And reparations open the door. That's why it's not an end in itself.
Take one more question.
Well, there's a couple ways to do that. It's definitely not 40 acres and a mule. And nor is it a poverty program. See, now, again, we can go back to this arguing about some people say, we already have reparations, it's poverty programs, one poverty in particular, invested billions of dollars and didn't go anywhere. But the problem with that argument is, A, in terms of welfare support, whether it's AFDC or whether it's other kinds of programs, social security programs, anything that helps people who actually need help, the majority of people who receive those funds are not black people. Okay. That's number one. And number two, a poverty program basically has a political and ideological attachment. The political attachment is that it's administered by a group of people who usually are not poor people, but people who make decisions on what the poor need, because the poor, of course, are not capable of empowering themselves, or making decisions. I did it up. Okay, that's a something wrong with you. And so that's what Queen Mother Moore is talking about. You think about the attachment, the ideological attachment of damage, being damaged goods, is precisely what, you know, transfer of funds could represent. If it's attached to a poverty program, the difference is that by just announcing that this is actually payment for the investment that this group of people and their ancestors put into this country to bring some equality. First of all, it's going to change the way people accept the money. You know, number one. Number two, and more importantly, is that the argument that they're making is not for food stamps, but it's for institutions, civic institutions, public institutions, not just more money into schools, but changing the way schools function based on the concept of self-determination. In other words, people in their communities can make decisions about how to do things. And the amazing thing for me is that if you really pay attention to demographics, that those communities are not always predominantly black communities. And so people have said to me, well, you know, then you should be counting heads. You can't count heads. You can't sort of find like the authentically black people. Because really, if you want to think about it, most of you are, whether you know it or not, you don't know who your ancestors are. You know? And it's amazing how when it comes to Native American benefits, suddenly people have Native American ancestry like out of nowhere. And they start benefiting from stuff like that. Now, I'm not saying that you would do that, but all I'm saying is that, you know, when you waste time counting heads and trying to determine who the authentic, real descendant of slaves are and who isn't, you miss the whole point of the movement. And the movement is about putting back into those communities that have been impacted by white supremacy, racism, class oppression, and other kinds of oppression that have an inordinate impact on people of African descent. And yet those who occupy those neighborhoods are oftentimes people who are new immigrants. And I insist that those new immigrants should have as much benefits to whatever reparations in the institutional form come. It's logical. If you think of this not as a national issue, but as a global issue. I mean, a lot of immigrants are here, just like in Southern Europe. Think about the cycles of immigration. A lot of it has to do with changes in a global economy, which threw people off the land and compelled them to come here. Southern Europe, Latin America, the Caribbean, global movements of the economy produced immigration. And those global movements are tied to the history of slavery itself. So, all I'm saying is that you don't have to have like a racial card to be able to benefit from this. And I think that the whole world can benefit if, you know, if you think of it as an institutional transfer in some ways. Because that's a lot. Oh.
Okay. The point is that the structural damage that was done
And that will go into details of it. There's a great book by Walter Rodney called How Europe Underdeveloped Africa, which just makes several important points. One of the most important points that I've seen is a demographic one. Every single continent between 1615 and 1850 had population growth, except for Africa. It's the only continent that had no population growth whatsoever. Why? Because not just actual movement of people, not just counting heads, but issues like fertility was affected by the violence, by the instability. The fact that you have states that emerged that are gangster states inside of Central Africa whose purpose was to just raid slaves. You know, an economy based on the theft of human beings and violent destruction cannot produce anything productive. You see? And so, in a sense, yes, it should be. But again, I don't expect to see like massive billions of dollars transferred from Europe to Africa. What I would love to see is, rather than just talk about new colonialism in Africa and dealing with those savages,
relief,
like,
relief of debt is
one of the arguments that we've been making for a long time, and that's necessary. It all is durable. But one of the thing that scares me most is that there's all this talk about sort of decolonizing Africa. And the way the language is used is no different than the 19th or late 19th century, the Berlin Conference. But in the end, it would be great if the leaders of Europe, North America, can think of Africa, Latin America, and Caribbean, not as third world nations, but as part of a global economy, not as providers of raw materials or markets that they have to dump stuff on, or markets they have to block, whether they're blocking South African steel or whatever, but part of their own lives, that they have a certain kind of global empathy, eliminate the idea that this is a second-rate, exploitative, place, but that they would want to put as many resources to transforming Africa and Latin America and all these places into something that's beautiful as they imagine the United States can be. You know, we're not there.